All right, everyone. If those of you who are still standing would go ahead and take your seats. I'm going to get started introducing our next speaker. Jennifer Stefano is Chief Strategist and Vice President at the Commonwealth Foundation. She oversees development, communication, and long-term strategic planning. Prior to joining the Commonwealth Foundation, Jennifer served in numerous leadership roles at Americans for Prosperity and Americans for Prosperity Foundation. The Emmy-nominated former TV reporter and anchor spent most of her career in the private sector, putting to work her business degree from Villanova University. She has spent the last decade advocating for public policies that maximize human flourishing and individual freedom. A native of Philadelphia, Jennifer is a regular commentator for The Hill. Her work has been published in numerous media outlets, including the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, the Philadelphia Inquirer, and FoxNews.com. She has been profiled by the Washington Post, the International Herald Tribune, Forbes, and other local and national publications. She is a guest commentator for national news programs on Fox News, Fox Business, CNBC, MSNBC, and CNN. In 2015, Jennifer was named one of the Claremont Institute's Leakin Fellows for her work and impact on national affairs. Please join me in welcoming Jennifer Stefano.
Well, hello to you. Please forgive my voice. No, it's not COVID. Is it yelling at leftists all day? Maybe. So you'll give me some leeway for that. So I might have to pause and take a couple of drinks of water now and again. So, you know, I've done a lot of terrifying things since getting into politics. I've debated leftists live on national television, with one of them F-bombing me while we were still live on air. I've been investigated by the IRS since getting involved in politics, run major protests, almost getting arrested sometimes. I've actually had unions follow me so that at one point one of my employers hired bodyguards. I've gotten mean-spirited and death threat-like comments directed at me and my children wishing us death, etc. But the most terrifying thing that ever happened was last year when I got a call from the vice president of YAF, Pat Coyle, and he said, Jennifer, we'd like you to come speak at our high school conference. And I was like, your high school conference? You mean like to teenagers? And I turned to my husband and he said, they want me to come speak to the high schoolers. And he's like, oh, they're gonna eat you alive, we're old now. And I'm like, yeah, no, I think that's right. And I thought about that because it really was one of the most nerve-wracking groups that I could ever dream of speaking to. Because I thought largely that Gen Z, from my Gen X self, by the way, greatest generation, favorite grandchild, Gen X of the greatest generation, united by a common enemy, two of them, our baby boomer parents and our questionable younger millennial siblings. But we, excuse me, give me a minute. For those of you, you might not be old enough to remember when Marco Rubio did that, when he gave his retort one time to after one of the State of Union addresses to President Obama. But it really was, my sense was that all high schoolers were largely cynical, largely like, whatever, and would not be particularly interested in hearing things about freedom or liberty or individual rights, and certainly not from a Gen Xer, and would not be particularly engaged. So imagine my total shock when I met people just like you and all of you. It became last summer when I went and spoke, one of the highlights of my professional career, second only to this moment, of being here with all of you, engaging with you all, and getting to see the Reagan Ranch. It has been remarkable. And I simply thank you. I'm watching your questions, I'm listening to you. And I was thinking back, and when I was getting ready for this, I'm like, what was I thinking about when I was your age? Like, largely, like, boys, and, like, being embarrassed by my parents and how not to be. I mean, I really, you know, now I am the parent that mortifies. Like, my husband and I showed up at our kids' school. We have a gaggle of children. And we thought, we always wear Halloween costumes. So he went as Ted Lasso, and I'm as Wonder Woman. And there comes a point in time, and you might not realize this, when you move from like, mommy, to like, mom. Oh my God. And my children were like, some of them, the older, were like, just pretend you don't know us. And I'm like, who are you talking to? Me? And it was me. And so I realized that, you know, I moved from being you to one day being the one that is your parent and embarrasses you. So thank you. Thank you for having the tolerance to listen to me today. And thank you to Governor Walker, to your Vice President, Pat Coyle, to the wonderful Madison, to all of you actually here at YAF who put this on. I agree with the Ian who just spoke before me that it takes an awful lot of work to put on events like this. And people like me just get to waltz in and be a beneficiary of it. So thank you. But I realized one thing, that when I was in coming into high school, I was walking into a world where Russia was not supposed to be anymore seen as the enemy. The Berlin Wall had fallen. Things were supposed to be now peaceful. We had written and said the words, we as Americans, our leaders, that we no longer see Russia as an existential threat, that communism has been definitively defeated. We walked, you know, I was a little itty bitty when Ronald Reagan was at the ranch, a retreat and a respite from his time in the White House. That's right. I was an itty bitty when Ronald Reagan was the president of the United States. I almost feel like I should apologize to all of you for that. And this is a man who turned around the economic fortunes of the United States. And because of his diplomacy, you know, a lot of people think Reagan was a militaristic president. Reagan was actually a man looking for peace. He was a pacifistic president. He realized that the buildup of the American military was required in order that people would understand that we had the means and the might and the will to use the arsenal, which also we believed Russia had, and they certainly did in the terms of nuclear weapons, but that his ultimate goal was to rid ourselves of nuclear weapons. He was very committed to that, to denuclearize the world, because he felt that that is the best way to peace and prosperity if only the two most powerful people would do it. But he was largely focused on using economic means, not via sanctions like we're seeing today, but by a free trade, by allowing Americans to be prosperous, by overseeing the largest tax cut, which I can't imagine when you're in high school is a particularly exciting or riveting thing. But one day you'll recognize that that gives individuals more of their own money. And when you have more of your own money, you can do things like buy private property and build churches or mosques or synagogues. You can buy private property and build homeless shelters or homes or soup kitchens or manufacturing sites and employ people. You can do and create jobs, come up with an idea, open a new world for people and individuals. You can do it anywhere in the country when more money is in your hands rather than in the hands of the government. The bigger the government, the smaller the citizen. Ronald Reagan understood that. So people like to accuse conservatives who believe in lower taxes of greed. Opposite. For who is it that wants to take the money from the working man and woman, but those sitting in power not earning it? That is the definition of greed. It is not greedy to want to keep what you earn and to use it for good. You know, today, how many of you have a phone? All of you, yes, which is something that my eldest repeatedly likes to tell me, that everyone in all of humanity has a phone. It was except for him, but he now has one. There is more computing power in your phones that you have in your hand today, even if you have an old one, than was used to take a man to the moon for the first time. And by the way, it was Americans who created both of those. Americans. So we had a German, I had a German au pair that she lived with us. She's a little bit older than you, she's in her 20s. So she came back to visit us recently. So we were talking. And she said to me, we're talking about social media. And she said, you know, I use it a lot. She goes, but you know, the Americans, you guys, you just dominate it. Like the Americans are all over Insta and Facebook and Twitter. And I'm like, yeah, hun, we invented it. That's why. Why don't you invent something? And then the Germans will be all over it. And that she looked at me and I looked at her. I'm like, what's stopping you? And she could not answer. And I thought one of you asked a very brilliant question. You asked a question of Ian, why? What is it about us about America that allows us to do these things? Like, what craziness is it? Is it our culture? Is it something in our DNA? Is it, what could it be that allowed us to do this? And I initially point back to American exceptionalism. Now, what is that? Everyone, you know, the left gets very angry about this. They don't like it. They think it's arrogant. You know, President Obama, when he was asked about American exceptionalism, he's like, well, you know, the Greeks think they're exceptional, Greek exceptionalism. And he used a couple of other nations. But he misunderstood what American exceptionalism is. It is that America is the exception to any other country in the world. In one very important way. It was the only nation in the world that started with expressing in word, written down, that the individual was greater than the government, than the state. That man was in himself virtuous and free, had a morality and a conscience which he should exercise for his and his community's benefit. All men are created equal, endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights, among them the life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. No one in civilization was saying that. No one wrote it down. No one manifested themselves into that. You can be as pissed off as Thomas Jefferson as you would like, or any other founding father, because they owned slaves, and they did. And it was morally reprehensible. Every single one of them in writing acknowledged that, even when they lived it out. Many of them were at a loss. Smart men like Washington, at a loss for how to end it. Many of them did things during their tenure to actually stop it, which is how you know their argument from the left is, well, this was all for white men, white privileged men, white educated men, white landowning men. Well, if that were true, they did a very poor job of keeping the power there. Under President Washington, he brought in the Northwest Territories as free territories, no slavery. It's one of his proudest achievements, right? He and Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson also ended for good under his presidency the slave trade. If these were men committed to keeping that vile institution or to keeping the power nestled amongst their white aristocracy, they failed. But alas, they did not fail. That was not their purpose or their point. They, whenever everyone hits on white men, I remind them, I would not be here today. I would not be casting a vote. I would not be all over national TV. I would not be published in the papers were it not for a group of highly educated white men voting to give up their power. To women of white men voting to give up their power to recognize that all men are created equal, meaning humankind, regardless of gender, regardless of race, regardless of ethnicity or origin, any of it. They continued to vote to give that up, to bring more of us in. It was not always pretty. It was not always easy. It was not always mutually agreed upon. They were not perfectly formed doves of humanity. They were failed, and yet they did things right. Can we not be smart enough and capable enough to acknowledge this without tearing down every monument and statue built to them? Can we not think critically? I tell my children I am a Roman Catholic. I believe Jesus is the Savior, and I am a conservative. I am raising my children in that tradition. But neither God nor the United States wants somebody to just do and accept and believe this. You have to choose this on your own. You have to think for yourself. And the way you do that is not simply by taking what people like I say, or people who think like you say, although you should listen and be educated, you should look at what the people who oppose you say, and you should give them a listen. You should think and hear them out. We won't want to do this anymore. too often we want to mirror what the left is doing. We are going to cancel the left and the leftist the minute they screw up, the minute they cause an offense, the minute we seize upon them with at the jugular and say how much they've offended us. Let us not be victims like they. How many of you read Orwell, George Orwell? How many of you think he nailed the leftism we're seeing today, of you that read him? Yeah. How many of you know that, wait, I'm gonna make you wait, it's suspense. There you go. That he was also a devout democratic socialist. He believed in socialism. This surprised the hell out of me. I'm like, whoa, wait a minute. I thought he was on my side. Guess what? It doesn't, you can concur with the conclusion someone's get, and they can come from a different worldview than you. There are often opportunities to meet even a leftist somewhere and start by what you both agree on. In fact, the great debate, the great orators, the great minds from Aristotle and Plato through Cicero and up through to today always know that to win a debate, to begin a debate, is to start at a point of consensus. If you are not finding any with those that oppose your worldview, you are not trying and you're not thinking. And if you are not thinking, we are not winning as a nation. President Reagan was a wonderful president, but he wasn't a perfect man, and he would tell you that. He never purported to be God, only that he relied on God. So don't even everything President Reagan did and said was right and perfect and moral, nor even appropriate for our times. You are not living in President Reagan's times. Like I said, you have more computing power today in your hands than he did in the whole arsenal of NASA during his presidency. It is not his times, but there is much we can learn, for in many ways he was timeless. So seek to learn from him and let him be a guide, but let not recreating and being him be your goal. For you and each of you sitting here today has the potential to lead us out of all the things that you talked about that were problems, from whether it is upending our gun rights or canceling people who don't agree or feeling as though that we have, that everything that you believe in is somehow racist or sexist or anti-somebody, that it is a vulnerable class of which you are not allowed to belong. You have to have the courage to be unpopular, not just in standing up to those ideas, but in telling those of us who adhere to the worldview that we might not always be right. It is going to be hard because the left will attack you and tear you down, but what I've sadly seen is a hardening on the right as well. Amongst libertarians and conservatism, I think Ian spoke a bit of it. You know, that we become myopic. We think we absolutely have to take this worldview because if we give an ounce of credence to the other side, they'll use it against us, yes, they will. But that doesn't mean you can't speak truth to power, even when the power largely aligns with what you agree. I see this happening with climate change. Steve Koonin is the former energy czar under President Obama. He wrote a magnificent book. It's called Unsettle. Just Google it while I take a drink, okay? It's called Unsettled. And in it, he wrote that there is an enormous debate among scientists who are supposed to just present truth, but that whether or not they should tell the truth about climate change, including that there are massive improvements happening in the climate, that it might not be as bad as the headlines and is being said, and that there are positive things going on that are reducing the impact of the climate. But he said the scientists don't want to acknowledge any of this, some of them, because they think the people who deny climate change will use it as a aha. And on the right, people like myself who look at things like NASA and others who believe the climate is changing, and there are some problems with that, don't want to admit that, right? Because then we will not only lose popularity amongst our own conservative and libertarian friends, but the left will use it to then harm other causes for which we believe. But I realize that lacks courage and it lacks conviction. And it's hard. You have hard things you must do. You know, when one of you asked a great question here about the idea of virtue or a moral people. So I think the first thing is what did our founders mean by, they largely used the word virtue, so I'm going to stick with that, virtue. They said religious and virtue. But from ancient times, you know, it came in the medieval times, religious and virtue under the Judeo-Christian world became one. But virtue, dating back to ancient Greece, which inspired Cicero, and it was Cicero of Rome that inspired our founding fathers, the ideas of virtue were putting off what you want now for what can be in the future. So this is exactly, and honestly, Ian and I did not coordinate, but I gotta say, hat tip to my friend there, because he spoke truth. Like, what is virtue? What is morality? It too often, like, this is comes up in the guise of sex, and I can't just believe I said sex in front of high schoolers, but there I did. And conservative ones at that, but no. Actually, virtue and morality weren't talked about in those realms. Initially, the idea was of prudence, of justice, of temperance. Those aren't words we really use today. Mental toughness and grit. How about that? Mental toughness meaning what? That you can endure, resiliency, that you can fall down, you can take a hit, you can hear things that offend you. You can hear things that are appalling to you. You can talk to people that hate you, and you cannot melt into a puddle. You can hold a thought without becoming a thought. Plato, that was virtue. And you can take what you want today and hold on it to get what you need for tomorrow. So the Declaration of Independence was not a bunch of white guys, in my opinion, writing down, here's how we're going to keep our power. It was a bunch of dudes writing down a mission statement that they knew they would not live to see fulfilled. They wrote down a vision. Even though the founding fathers were very against leaders with a vision, they thought the individuals should decide what the country is. No leader should cast a vision. Today we're all about our leaders casting visions, something to think about. But they largely believed that this is what should be, but it is not what will likely be in our lifetime. But we must do everything we can to advance it. And that's what I think something you can take from President Reagan. His great optimism. It is not easy to be optimistic in these times. I totally understand that, especially on the brink of World War III, and it's certainly not easy to speak up. I especially think for the girls. I read a study that we're less likely to raise our hands to speak up. We're less likely to want to do that. But we have to do that. We have to do that. And we do it not only on behalf of ourselves, but after the boys sitting next to you who will go fight largely the next world war. Yes, women are virtuously serving in our military, but there is no reasonable human being that can statistically look at who sacrifices more. It will be our boys and our men. Since 9/11, there have been slightly over 7,000 death casualties, military casualties. 177 of them are women. 6,800 plus are the men. And that doesn't include the 13 that were killed outside of the Kabul Air Force Base when we pulled out of Afghanistan in August. So girls, I would argue we have to speak up for ourselves because you have every right, because it's okay to be unpopular. We're raised to be pleasing. We're raised to be nice. I didn't get the memo and I didn't pass the class well. But niceness and kindness are different things. Speaking truth to power might be the kindest act you ever do, not only for the person in power, but the people who might suffer under the power, should you not be the one to challenge it. It ain't nice, but it is kind. And we are now facing what I thought we never would, which is a war, a world war. And I'm old. It ain't gonna be me and the men my age that are gonna fight it. It will be you. It will be my children. They're younger than you. On their behalf, on my behalf, on your, I implore you to have the courage to be unpopular today. My opinion is that you will not have to be physically courageous in battle if we could be morally courageous every day. My generation failed to do it. We kept our heads down if we thought a professor was liberal or leftist. And yeah, that was happening when I was in college. You just kept your head down. You kind of ignored it. You could ignore politics back then. Today, I tell my children, take the F, fail the class, get a lower grade. I tell my children, if you are not speaking up and you're not somehow getting expelled, suspended, or in trouble, you are either at Hillsdale or you are not doing the right thing. And even at Hillsdale, don't just assume something is virtuous today because it was yesterday. It needs good people pushing back, challenging. The world needs you. It needs people of moral courage. And I go back to what the moral courage is. It's about willing to be unpopular, to be willing to have people not like you, to not be seen as nice, to not be seen as compliant. And girls, I am talking to you. Do not be seen as the perfect conservative, but rather to be loud. To, yes, sometimes use your anger righteously. I tell my children, Jesus righteously used his anger. No, don't go flipping tables. That was his temple. That was his house. If you want to own a house, you want to flip tables in it, fine. But largely, anger can be righteous. Just don't flip tables. And also, don't be afraid. And this is the most important thing. To engage on a human level those whom you despise the most. And this is where I do go back to my Roman Catholic beliefs. I realized that I was misunderstanding the parable of the Good Samaritan for a very long time. And the parable of the Good Samaritan can be found in many, many religious traditions, almost all of them. Is everyone familiar with the parable of the Good Samaritan? Right? What does he do? He's out on the road. He's a wealthy man, right? He had money. So Jesus tells this story because he was asked, how do you get to heaven? He said, love God with all your heart and all your soul and love your neighbor as yourself. And a lawyer in the room said, yeah, but who's my neighbor? And classic lawyer, right? Like, let's define terms. And so Jesus gives this example. He's like, well, there's this guy, this good Samaritan. This, he didn't call him good. Jesus never called him good. In fact, Jesus wasn't the one that called him good. And the lawyer was. And the lawyer was an Israelite. And so Jesus gives this example of the Samaritan. He's a wealthy man, and he picks up the man on the road who's poor and beaten, and the priest and the rabbi go past that guy, and he brings him, and he pays for him, and then he goes on, and he said, here's extra money. I'm going to come back when I pass through, get him medical care, take good care of him. When I come back through, I'll pay again, make sure he's okay. In my life, the Good Samaritan laws are all about what? Helping who? A stranger. Stranger's not your neighbor. That wasn't who Jesus was actually talking about. Because he goes back to the lawyer at the end of the parable, and he says to the lawyer, and who was your neighbor in that? And the Israelite, it was the Samaritan. And he couldn't even say the name. He said it was the one who did good. Why? Because the Israelites and the Samaritans are like the Democrats and Republicans of today. They looked like each other, sounded like each other, largely believed and shared the same culture, but hated each other. They were abhorrent to the Israelites, the Samaritans. They were less thans. It was like if they told that parable, Jesus told that parable to AOC. And so what I say to you is, what I think, whether you do or don't believe in Jesus, is you must engage your Samaritan. You must engage the one you find abhorrent, that you don't agree, that you don't believe in. And you must see in them humanity. For you will never be a virtuous person until you first see God in others. And you cannot see God in others until you stop and seek first to understand, rather than be understood. I didn't always do that well. It took me far too long. My generation and the generations before me did not do that far too well. It's why we're here today. But I am confident, especially after my time here, that there is a new generation of Americans rising. And I, for one, no longer make fun of Gen Z, millennials 100%, like deserved. But not you, not your generation. Not high schoolers, not teenagers today. You're a new generation, born in this century. I hope you are not like those born in the last century, often tempered by war. That early generation, those born in the 1900s and the 1920s, they were tempered by war. I hope that is not for you. And I believe, should you do what you need to, you won't be. But as we go into this great endeavor of the future, I thank you for what you're doing. I thank you for being here. I thank you for listening. I thank you, for allowing it. Godspeed and God bless. Oh,
All right, we'll open it up for questions. If you have a question for Jennifer, come to the back.
Hello, my name is Joseph Levy from Phoenix, Arizona. I'm homeschooled, and I was wondering, do you think the U.S. is going to get involved and send troops over to Ukraine?
Thank you, Joseph. So do I think the United States is going to send troops to Ukraine? No. I do not think that the United States will send troops to Ukraine. Ukraine is a sovereign nation. We have no treaty with Ukraine. And it would, in my opinion, and I think in the opinion of most of the Joint Chiefs of Staff and even the President, that this is not for us to intervene in Ukraine. Now, I know some people think, well, we should preemptively strike, but I actually think President Biden is correct. So no, but what my concern would be is that the President has been very clear, and I think he is right on this as well. So see, yes, Democrats can be right, that if the Russians were to go into NATO countries, of which there are many, there are some former Soviet bloc that Putin would want back, the United States, the President Biden has said, which has long been our foreign policy, that should the Russians go into a NATO country, they are at war with the United States. So no, not into Ukraine, but yes, possibly should they go into a NATO country. The only thing I'll tell you is our generals in the United States are utterly shocked at the failures of the Russian military, but we know from Sun Tzu and the Art of War, we never underestimate those that we oppose, so.
Thank
Does
you.
That help?
Yeah, it does. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Emily Levy, and I'm also from Scottsdale, Arizona, and I'm homeschooled. So my question for you is, you mentioned in the very beginning of your speech how people are rejecting the idea of American exceptionalism. How can we bring that back in today's society as teenagers?
So I love that question and that you care about it. Thank you. I'm just hearts over all your heads right now. That's all I can see. I think so first it's define it for people, because if you're arguing that American is exceptional for some, you know, because we invent things or because like we do capitalism or because we're a constitutional republic or we had a revolution, that's not why we're exceptional. None of those things are particularly in and of themselves exceptional per se, or even definitively moral. What American exceptional is, so first I would largely argue you to define the term and be humble about it, which is we are the exception to the world in that we founded this country, that the man is greater than the state. This is shocking, right? And the second thing is, why does that matter? Why should anyone care? The ultimate question that you can ask people as teenagers when you're talking to teenagers, they absolutely hate authority. Like, I've never met a teenager that did not think their parents were ruining their lives. Like, you guys should be the ultimate, like, anti-authoritarians, right? True, you're right, right? I'm gonna get in trouble with your mom's dads, hopefully you're not watching. But, and I have children too, and one's a teenager, so I get it. But you ask that any of your kids your age, like someone your age, who knows more about your life? Like, and who's better to make decisions, you or the government? Like, do you think you're why do you want someone to tell you how to live? They don't. Well, why do you think anyone else wants them to tell you how to live? And I always think there's just this is where the left really looks down on the poor and people of it's just shocking to me. It's like, well, they need the help. No, actually, they don't. They need you to stop what you call helping, which is actually dampening human flourishing. So that's how I would do it. I think discussions in the form of the question are always useful.
All right,
but God bless for caring.
Hi, I'm Sarah. I'm from Buchanan High School. And my question is, you said that with a debate, you have to start with a point of consensus, but what if they refuse and just begin attacking you and completely refuse to hear you out?
Then find in that argument what you agree with. So yeah, when, you know, jiu-jitsu, it's the art, I never studied jiu-jitsu, but my understanding is it's using somebody's force as your power. Use their anger, their hate, their attack on you as your power. Don't see it as an attack. Redefine it as the basis for the debate, right? So, you know, let's say that I'm great, and that's where I would largely argue when they say, you're very greedy. Okay, I'll agree with you. We're very greedy. So let's say that we are greedy people, why then do we want to give money back to individuals? Why don't we just take over the government? And then not only when we take over the government, not give tax cuts, but uniformly declare ourselves dictators, right? So you can, any argument, just agree with it initially. Be like, yes, let's agree that I'm this, or let's agree that I'm that. And then find a way, you have to mentally be swift, to turn that around to advance your point. And that is using it as energy to drive it towards a greater end. It's not easy. It takes practice, but it can be done. And yes, they will come out attacking and swinging, and they won't want to agree about anything. Sometimes it's like, do we all agree we breathe oxygen? Absolutely not if a conservative does.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah.
Hi. I'm Craig Nakagawa from Randolph-Macon Academy in Front Royal, Virginia. And my question was, with the Catholic Church becoming more corrupt by the left, I see myself falling farther away from God since I am Catholic. What should I do as a Catholic conservative to stay close to God and still stay conservative and not be corrupt by the Catholic Church and the left?
Mm-hmm. So did you, Greg or Craig?
Craig.
Craig.
Yes.
Okay. So first, thank you for that really difficult question. It is a really tough one, and I understand that a lot of people feel there are corrupting forces within the church, which is going to be true in any church because it's made by man. It's made by man in an effort to worship God. So that's true. I would say let no man ever push you from God. That is not the man. That is a choice of yours, and recognize that. That is a choice. Man is corrupted. We know that. In fact, the very minute you say you're Roman Catholic, aka a Christian, yes, Roman Catholics are Christian. We actually were there at the foot of the cross, right? But my point, and this is very personal, right? We're talking about religion now. We're getting out of the secular and into the religious. But I would say to you, and I can talk to you privately about this afterwards, let no man ever, no human, no person, come between you and God. Man is going to be corrupted. We each are, you are, I am. If you say you're a Christian, you are not announcing virtue, you are announcing failure. That you have acknowledged that you are a failed human being, that you yourself cannot fix this, that we cannot save ourselves. When you announce that you're a Christian, it should be done in all humility of our overwhelming failure. And starting from that in a prayer life, and I'll give you my favorite Bible verse, and I would largely point you to start going directly to the Bible as well, because this is what I did when I was upset with the church during the scandals with pedophiles, was Matthew 7:7. Ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door will be opened unto you, forever asked is given, whoever seeks find. And whoever knocks, the door is open unto him. So if you ask God to help you with this enormous struggle, I find that God does, not always in the way you want. He's not going to make the church, you know, the church is corrupt because humans are corrupt. But I think you can be transformative. So go directly to God, go directly to Jesus in your faith. Okay. And we could talk afterwards, yeah. And, it's, you know, I'm smacking the pulpit a bit here, but I know, you know, President Reagan was quite religious, and I think it's fine to talk about faith. And we used to be told, don't talk about religion, don't talk about politics, don't talk about race. I think actually talk about all of it from a place of honesty and respect. Really powerful question, Craig. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Kate. I'm homeschooled in Orange County, California, but I also go to an in-person one-day-a-week school. So what I wanted to ask you is, in my school, I want to stand up and I want to speak my opinions. I'm a very opinionated person and I enjoy politics, but the career that I want, it needs a college degree. And to get into college, or preferably Hillsdale, I need a good GPA. And so do you have any advice on how I can balance the two?
Yes. I fundamentally think if you feel that you are being targeted by a teacher or a professor and that it will hurt your grade because of your viewpoint, there has to be, this is where I know, look, whenever something happens at school, my first thought is like, I'm going up there. And the last thing kids want, like, please don't come up there, mom, like a, you know, like a bat out of hell, please just stay. But I do believe this is where your parents can be very helpful to you. And there has to be the discussion. But also do not believe people get in to colleges with all sorts of GPAs. And if you wrote a powerful essay about why your GPA wasn't good and how you stood up for yourself and how that was used against you. That is incredibly powerful. No, not every college will take you, but I know a lot of higher ed institutions recognize that one of their many failures in their diversity pursuits is the failure to actually bring in people who think differently than their ideology, and they're recognizing that. It is a fine line, it is a fine balance, but you will lose far more by not speaking up than you will ever gain by ducking for cover. But I appreciate the question. I know how hard it is.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Angelica, and I attend Trinity Classical Academy here in Southern California. And my question is rebellion bad, and how do we as Christians stand up to our government but also respect them and, like, not rebel against them? I get a little bit confused when I think of what Paul said to the Romans when it was, like, respecting your authorities but also standing up to them. So I'm a little confused how you can balance that.
Yeah, that's a great question, Angelica. First of all, thank you for it. Second, rebellion against God, bad, I would love to, and other rebellions, questionable. So I do agree that there are, and again, I just want to be really clear. I'm a Roman Catholic, so y'all know I'm not a preacher, right? Like, girls aren't allowed to be that in the Roman Catholicism. But to me, how I understand it, is first you have to have a prayer life. You have to ask directly these questions of God, and you have to pray for that. And that is my fundamental start. And second, yeah, don't rebel against God when things don't go well on earth. You know, the idea of being prospered by God is not the prosperity gospel that we're all going to be rich and living in pools and mansions. That's not, in my opinion, what he actually meant. To be prospered by God is to grow closer to God, to live a life of virtue closer to God. That's prospering. That doesn't mean it's always going to be easy. So when you are confronting a government, you have to look at what are and what does the government stand for and what specifically are you rebelling against. And I think when we talk about our government being based on Judeo-Christian principles, number one, it's the respect for life, right? What was the ultimate gift God gave us? God gave us life. And then what was the second thing he did, and why is our government virtuous? Why do we consider it Judeo-Christian? It's not just we protect and acknowledge life, but liberty. What does that mean? It's liberty of what? It's not free liberty to do whatever we want. Conscience. God gave us a conscience. He didn't have to. He could say, you choose me, I made you, you will worship me. He didn't do that. He gave us, he said, he recommended, hey, don't eat from the tree of knowledge. But we did, right? And he loved us anyway, so much so that he sent his son to die for us, so that we could be redeemed. So why am I saying all that to you? Because the aspects of government that you want to rebel against are ones that don't respect life, that don't respect moral conscience, by the way, and that it can include, you know, I think there's a lot of debate now around whether the government should or should not have ever been against, from a civil, gay marriage, right? And whether as Christians you should or should not, from a governmental perspective, fight that versus what you would do and protect for your individual liberty in your church. These are not easy things to think about, but I would always take it, first, start with your prayer life. Second, take it from why, what do we mean by a Judeo-Christian country? And I think those two things, life and a moral conscience and ensuring the government respects those, that's where you rebel, when those are infringed upon.
Thank you.
But peacefully, please.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Cassidy Hassel. I'm from California. As a woman, people continually tell you that you're oppressed and will always have less rights. This has created what I feel is a hatred toward men in general. My question is, what is the best argument or defense against those who try to convince women that they are still without the common rights in America, as well as those who try to claim that all men are quote-unquote womanizers?
Okay, you are the best argument, and you, all the women in this room are the best argument, because you are simply, it is just ridiculously untrue. In fact, men and boys are largely not the ones in the room, but are largely falling behind in society. There is no scientific claim behind what they're saying about women have less rights than men. In fact, women are doing far better than men. We're outpacing and outperforming them, not only in our GPA averages, but in our graduation rates from high school and college and in the workforce. So the idea that somehow you could continue to victimize or treat women as victims is hugely problematic. So I think start there, but also live your life in a way that is exemplifies this. My thing is celebrate and celebrate men, celebrate boys. And we try, and I fundamentally try to do that, and all the boys are like, this is so embarrassing. Why are you being having this conversation? I hate this conversation. But it's true. There was a time when men had to come and step up to our defense, when we had to have them fight for our rights, when we had to have them. And again, when none of us were alive during this time, I know I might be old, but I wasn't alive when the women got the right to vote. My great-grandmother was. And it's just, there was a time when men had to go out and swing for women to make sure our rights were fought for. Today, we actually have to make sure that men are not going to be left behind. So to me, the mere fact you ask the question and that you're unafraid to punch back against it, and no, don't ever, the endless, you know, this concept that the only way to have a valid voice is to have a voice of a victim is wrong. And it's oppressive, it's a form of oppression. It's a form of mental slavery, in my opinion, that keeps people down and lets women, especially young women, think that others are in charge of how well they will advance rather than they themselves. It's just moral treachery, in my opinion. And it doesn't mean that there cannot, at a point in life, we all can't be victims of something or a crime, but to live your life as one, no. It's just the most successful people I know never looked at themselves that way. Not women, not men. I mean, from Harriet Tubman, Nelson Mandela. I look at these people. They never saw themselves as a victim, even though they were. They could very easily have claimed it. Great question.
Thank you.
Well done.
All right, we have time for one final question.
Afternoon. My name is Grace Riley, and I'm from Yucaipa, California. I'm homeschooled. My question is for you in regards to a question from earlier from another student. You said that you think that the one thing the Democratic Party has done pretty well is stay out of the war in Ukraine, correct?
I said no. I think I didn't say the Democratic Party. I said President Biden.
Oh, sorry.
And what I think that he did that was right is we're not sending boots on the ground into Ukraine at this time.
Okay.
So staying out of it, I would say no, we haven't stayed out of that situation. Mm-hmm. We have not sent boots on the ground, which I do think is correct. Now, whether if you want to argue, did we stay out of it? No, we haven't stayed out of it. We've been very vocal about it, which, you know, we can all talk about. Is that or is that not staying out of it? I would argue it's not. But
so I guess my general question would be, what do you think of the Budapest Memorandum?
You will have to tell me what the Budapest Memorandum contains, my dear, because I actually don't. Educate me.
So from what I understand, the Budapest Memorandum was a contract signed between America, Ukraine, and I think Russia. I'm not very clear on this, but it was when Ukraine had a lot of the, what were they called? It had a lot of firearms. Very specific.
Right. And you mean when the Americans worked with the Ukrainians to
nuclear weapons? Yeah. So yeah. Ukraine contained a lot of the nuclear weapons. Russia threatened to attack Ukraine if it kept the weapons. America made a deal that if Ukraine gave up the weapons, it would protect it from Russia.
Right. So I am not familiar with the actual memo of what you're referring to. I am aware that the work was done by America through that we would work with the Ukrainians to demilitarize, because the Russians were very concerned about that the Americans were using this to come invade Russia. So I don't have an answer to your question. And by the way, I don't know is an acceptable answer, 100%. And I don't know, to answer your question, I did not read the Budapest memo. But here's what I will say, and this is kind of interesting. We are fighting a war of another generation, and always and have largely been with Russia. I was totally astounded to learn that Vladimir Putin was absolutely convinced that our actions, the actions of the United States in Slavic nations, were, in his mind, an effort for America to eventually invade Russia. Like, if you could ask me what is, like, absolutely one thing every American, no matter how radically left or right, totally agrees upon, there's, like, no question in anyone's mind, I would have said to you, well, none of us want to invade Russia. Zero. Like, some of us want to, like, live like maybe former Soviet bloc because the leftists, but no one. There is no one, no politician, no one ever argued that, ever, to the American public, nor would that president be sitting in office for very long should he execute upon that, Democrat or Republican. So it astounded me that Vladimir Putin actually believed that. So I had to, and this is where it is very hard, and very hard even for me still, to think about what is actually the appropriate stance here. Because then I went back and looked at some of the actions of the United States, and I read people who I don't necessarily believe or agree with their worldview, but they gave a different take on why it happened. Now, this is the blame America first crowd, that somehow it's everything, everywhere, of all times is America's fault, which I do not believe. But largely, our posturing often, sometimes, towards Russia is that they are still an enemy rather than someone we should be working with and more of an ally. And after the fall of the Berlin Wall and after Gorbachev resigned in December 25th, 1991, not the only miracle on Christmas was Jesus, that too happened after President Bush spoke to him the night before. We were supposed to be working with Russia towards more allyship, not necessarily allies, but allyship. And so that America added some of the Slavic nations of former Soviet bloc into NATO caused enormous concern in Russia. And I don't think it is America's fault that Russia and Ukraine are at war, but I think we have to rethink, and this is where your generation can be different. Don't fight the last war. Americans always do this. Don't fight the last war. And I think that is largely what happens. It can lead to enormous problems. If we are going to be leaders of the free world, then we must at all times be leaders of the free world. You know, if we accept the honor and the honorific, we accept the responsibility. But no, I'm not, this is not America's fault per se, but I think the actions America took, including, I think, lifting sanctions, some sanctions on Russia, did give Vladimir Putin a sense that we were interested in moving even forward into Russia, and that we would unilaterally weaker than, say, under previous presidents, and would be less willing to fight.
Thank you.
Great, oh my gosh. A remarkably impressive group of you. Like, could you come run the government quickly? Could we lower the age from president from 35 to how old are you guys average? Like, Lord, we should just ban anyone over 35 from being in government would largely be my answer. What? Yeah. Incredibly impressive. Much obliged. Like, I leave confident in our future, not something that often happens when I speak. I'm largely left feeling rather grim. Well done, you. Well done, you. And thank you for all you're going to do and all you're going to sacrifice for all of us.